what we're about to do yield favorable results, may give us the capacity to benefit others, may help us overcome ignorance and limitation, may clear away all obstacles on the path, may lead us to the union of wisdom and compassion. Om Ahum Soha.
We are reviewing, studying a text called 7 Points of Mind Training by Chekawa Geshe Dorje. And as the title implies, there are 7 points, and there are underneath those 7 points, there are 63 different proverbs or instructions. In the few times that we have already met, we've looked at the first of the proverbs or instructions first, training the preliminaries. And just very briefly, the preliminaries are this precious human birth that we have now, this great opportunity to study and practice the Dharma, spirituality. The reality of permanence and death, the fact that we don't know how long we have this precious human birth. The third thought that turns the mind towards the Dharma is the understanding of karma, the law of cause and effect, and how every act that we have performed, that we are performing, and will ever perform, will have consequences, which means we have to be very cautious about what we do. And the fourth thought that's included in the preliminaries is the fact that material life is suffering. Of course, there are pleasures and there are joys. Buddhism is a negative religion or philosophy, and we're not supposed to be going around sour. In fact, if you've met many Buddhists, it's usually a good sense of humor involved, right? And a lot of laughter. Because all of it is not really that important. There's nothing to pull your hair out about, of course. Some of us don't really have a choice on that matter, but nothing is really that important. But we have to understand very, very clearly that merely making a material adjustment will not make us permanently happy. What does that mean? It means you're not going to be permanently happy if you get that boyfriend or girlfriend. You're not going to be permanently happy if you get that job, or that pair of tennis shoes, or the new iPhone, or whatever it is. You've experienced this all before, right? You've wanted something, you got it. Are you happy? Are you permanently happy? This is the nature of material existence. So what do we understand when we come to the conclusion that material life is not going to make us happy? That if we actually want to be happy, we have to turn to spirituality. Like the Buddha said, we are living in a burning house, and it is not wise to redecorate, right? Or move furniture around, or engage in games while the house burns around us. The only reasonable thing to do is get out. And we can do so. It is not impossible. It is actually our nature to be permanently happy. Right? And today we're going to look at some of that. So from there we went to formal practice, which is the second of the 7 points. And under that, there are two divisions, the absolute mind of enlightenment and the relative mind of enlightenment. And we've covered instructions or proverbs 2 through 6, which are about the absolute mind of enlightenment. I don't have time to go through them, but basically we are instructed to take a proper view of reality and to understand that most of our perceptions, if not all of our perceptions, are due to our perspective. Things are not as we experience them. Things are not as we see them. We see things as we are. Perhaps the easiest way to explain that is other animals have senses that are very different from ours, right? That have greater capacity. Some of them have smaller capacity. Do they see the same thing we see when we look at something? No, they see something different. So the point that the Dharma makes is that it is our constitution, it is our organization as beings, right, that determines what we see, what we hear, what we touch, what we feel, what we think, what we perceive. It is not reality out there that we're actually capturing somewhat. No, it is what our senses and our minds allow us to perceive. We would not ask a dog to sing opera. They don't have the vocal capacity. Some of them try. They do, they try. But they don't have the vocal capacity. That is something that actually, I think, only humans can do. And blessedly so. Because most of the humans who try shouldn't. Right? By the way, I love opera. Even they have a squeaky sound. So it is our, we call this a karmic formation, and there's two types, right? The karmic formation that gives us the body and the karmic formation that gives us our mind. We have certain capacities dictated by our physical constitution, and we have certain capacities and limitations dictated by our mental constitution. Can we agree on that? That's a very brief. But ultimately, and this is a point that we're going to return to today, that's why I wanted to come to this, ultimately, regardless of those limitations, particularly of the mind, every single sentient being, and you are a sentient being, every single sentient being has purity and clarity. When you stop the agitation, the only thing that remains is peace. When you stop the confusion, what remains is clarity. You don't have to create the peace. You don't have to create the clarity. The peace and the clarity are there. In fact, they are the natural state. Just like when you shake one of those little globes that are full of, I don't know, confetti or something, right?
Snow globes,
right? You shake them, right? And they're all turbid and moving. What do you have to do? Do you have to go in with pincers to remove each one of those little things? No. You set it down. And what happens? All of that comes to the bottom, and you see clearly through the globe, right? The mind is like that. Its nature is to be clear. Its nature is to be peaceful. Emptiness and clarity are the defining characteristics of the mind. I know that some of you may think, my mind is never empty. Actually, your mind can be full of thoughts precisely because it's empty. Think about it. If it weren't empty, where would you have your thoughts? If your house weren't empty, where would all the furniture be? If your house were a solid block of concrete, you could fit nothing in it. So it is emptiness that allows for things to manifest, to appear. Your mind, you don't have to empty the mind. That is a very peculiar thing that some people teach. You know, empty your mind, that's meditation. You don't have to empty the mind, your mind is empty. What you have to do is settle down. And it's naturally the peace and clarity manifest. So then we looked at perhaps the key to mind training, which is exchange meditation in Tibetan Tonglen, giving and taking. And when we looked at this, we said that the only difference between a Buddha, a fully enlightened being, and an ordinary sentient being, and this is not my opinion, this is stated by great masters such as Shantideva, the only fundamental difference is that sentient beings want happiness for themselves, and the Buddhas want happiness for everybody. They care about the happiness of others, they don't care about their happiness, because they understand that there is no separation, there is no duality. If everybody is happy, they are happy.
Tashi?
Yes.
If you're seeking to be happy for yourself, and your search is true, as you go, won't you begin to desire the happiness of others?
Yes, but it is a long and arduous road full of frustration. So it is better to hear the teaching and understand and skip all that extra suffering. Because yes, sooner or later you'll get to it, seeking your own happiness. But only by getting slammed down over and over and over will you come to understand this is not the way.
But aren't we seeking our happiness here? I'm not understanding the difference.
Yes, we are, but how? See, everybody wants to be happy. But most do not know by material means or by gaining advantages, even so-called spiritual advantages. There are paths out there, right? So-called religious paths that aim at cultivating superiority over other beings. I am more righteous, I am more pure, I am more elevated, I levitate and you don't. Right? I shine, you know, I manifest things, I, you know, produce, you know, magical watches. All these things are there. All these things are there. Right? I have such spiritual power that I have 64 Rolls Royces. So, yes, everybody wants to be happy. You know, the amoeba wants to be happy. Literally, right? You know, an amoeba, a one-celled organism, if you put it on a Petri dish and you put a drop of sugar water, not immediately close, but in the proximity, the amoeba will move towards the sugar water. If you put a drop of something toxic, it will move away from it. Every sentient being wants to move towards happiness and away from suffering. The problem is we don't know how. We think we're going to be happy if we go to NASCAR. Or, you know, whatever, fill in the blank, right? Oh, that's going to make me happy. Yes.
You just went on to full enlightenment and didn't stay back to, like, help everybody the way the Buddha
did. Oh, yes, he did. For 45 years, after enlightenment. And he's still with us. So what happens is that understanding that that is the difference, we actually have the key of how to become enlightened. And it's not, I'm not going to say it's a, you know, what is it they call it here, a cakewalk? It's not a cakewalk, but it's not rocket science. If every time you meet, you encounter a sentient being, by the way, all sentient beings are not human, right? All animals are sentient beings, insects are sentient beings, birds, fish, not plants though. Plants are not sentient beings. They are living beings. We made the distinction. We couldn't eat if they were sentient beings. Right? So we have the key here. The key is giving and taking. What do we give? We give them all our happiness. Now, granted,
some of us don't have much happiness to give right now, right? But if you give what you have, whatever it may be, you are acting as a Buddha. And if you do your best, even if it's just in your mind, to take their suffering into your heart, you are behaving like a Buddha. And literally, in the beginning, the transformation is all internal. But little by little, I promise you, I guarantee it, you will have the actual capacity of removing the suffering of others. Haven't you ever been in front of somebody who just being with them makes you feel better? And conversely, right? There's some people just being with them makes you feel worse. And they don't have to do anything. When I was a little child and I was sick, when my paternal grandmother would show up in the house, and my room was in the back, when she walked in that front door, I knew she was there because I felt better already. Without her doing anything, it's like my grandmother is here, everything is right as rain. I don't know why they say right as rain. Because last night, rain wasn't right.
In Texas, rain is always right.
It is.
That's true with the droughts and things here, but you know, we lost power for many hours. You know, we're just winging
it. Oh, no.
Being in a strange place full of boxes and not knowing where your candles are. Anyhow, so this giving and taking is actually not some fancy technique. It's literally when you encounter a sentient being and we're surrounded by them, at least in the beginning, at least mentally, wish them all happiness and take in all their suffering. What does taking in all their suffering mean? It's not that you're going to go suffer for them. It means be willing to remove their suffering, bring it into your heart and purify it. And it is not a fancy technique. In some lineages, it has become a fancy technique. With us, we say mounted on the breath. What is that? What is the activity all humans do most often? Breathing. Mounted on the breath does not mean like some people. I've seen people like, oh, I'm doing tongling. No. Mounted on the breath means make sure that it becomes your nature. Just as you breathe all the time, even when you're sleeping, the desire to give happiness to others and to take away their suffering should become your normal state. That's what mounting it on the breath means, especially when you don't feel like it. Especially when it's somebody that is not likable. So that's as far as we had come. It is the key to enlightenment. It is literally beginning to act. You've heard the phrase, act as if. You begin to act as if you are a Buddha, and because you are behaving like a Buddha, you are. It literally transforms you. If you are acting the same way that an enlightened person acts, what is the difference? What is the difference? There is no difference. In the beginning, yes, you're play acting. And it's not constant, it's not mounted on the breath, but it's your aspiration. And it increases. And as it increases, you find that you actually have the capacity to bring happiness to others and to remove their suffering. In our lineage in particular, we say that there are seven signs and symptoms. As we begin our transformation, as our energies flow purely and freely without impediment, there are seven signs and symptoms. And they are not to be taken literally. But what is the first one? Healing the sick doesn't mean that you're, you know, going to hang out a shingle like, ooh, spiritual healing done here. No, it's that your presence is healing. Sickness of the body is important. I'm not saying it's not important, but the most important sickness is of the heart. We're all crying all the time. Even when we're laughing like clowns, we're crying. That is important healing. If your presence can heal the sick, you are moving in that direction. So healing the sick, nourishing the young. That doesn't mean that you're going to open a little, you know, child care center and you're going to force feed them. Nourishing the young means whenever you see someone who needs help being raised up, you have at least the inclination, even if you don't have the means, but you have the inclination to help them. Healing the sick, nourishing the young, protecting the weak. We may not have the capacity at all times, but again, it's developing the inclination when you see weak beings in danger, whether they be human or animals or otherwise, that your natural inclination is to protect them, not to kick them while they're down, which is unfortunately what our culture teaches. So healing the sick, nourishing the young, protecting the weak. This one is very easy to misinterpret. I was going to say something like George W. Bush. What was it that he said? It was a very complex misunderstanding. It's very easy to misunderestimate this one. Loving the beautiful. It doesn't mean that all of us now, right, fall in love with whoever is the beau of the moment and the belle of the moment. It's not that, you know, I know I'm dated when I say, you know, like, it's not Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie, but I know that it's now, what's the guy's name now? I don't know, Tatum something. Potato. Yeah, Cher. Whatever it is. It's not that we fall in love with those beautiful. No. Loving the beautiful means that we actually start discovering the beauty of every sentient being and actually seeing it. It's not just that, oh, I'm going to look for it. Ooh, hard as it is in this case. It's that we actually begin to see it. Even in the people we don't like, we start saying, you know, like, you know, he has a knack for evil. He's good at it.
You're a really good liar?
Hey, you know, it's admirable. It's admirable. So, loving the beautiful. The next one, serving the good. What does that mean? Whenever you see some other being doing useful, helpful work on behalf of other sentient beings, that you have the inclination to help. That's what serving the good means. The next one is honoring the wise. It doesn't mean bring incense and wave it in front of them. How do you honor the wise? By following their advice. It's the only way to honor the wise is to, if you ask for advice, take it. That's how you honor the wise. Like, you know, we used to say, like, honor your debts. It doesn't mean, you know, worship your debts. It means pay them, right? So honor the wise does not mean worship the wise like we do very much. You know, I'm sorry, and please don't take this as an attack on any particular church, but there's a lot of people, and it's not restricted to Christianity, there's a lot of people who worship Jesus but don't follow his advice. Worship Buddha but do not follow his advice. Worship Muhammad but do not follow his advice. That is not honoring the wise. That is dishonoring the wise. If you claim to be a disciple of Jesus, do what Jesus told you. Don't go around saying in the name of Jesus and, you know, slapping people. You know what was the slogan of the Crusades as they ran into, you know, cities, right, full of men, women, and children? God wills it. God wills it? Where is that? And the other side, in the name of Allah, the merciful. So honoring the wise means take the advice. They have all given excellent advice. Excellent advice. And we honor them by following. And the last one of the seven signs and symptoms is aligning with the highest. What does that mean? You know, at any given time in our lives, we have a conception that for us is the highest. So live up to your highest concept. That's what it means. You start living up to your highest concept. It may not be the highest, but it's your highest. You can't go beyond what you see, but at least align with it. A lot of people say, oh yeah, that'd be great, but I'm not going to do that. Most of us, let's be honest. Oh yeah, that'd be wonderful, but eh. I'm going to go there just now. That's the right thing to do, but I'm not going to do the right thing just now. Like, who was that? Saint Augustine, was it? And he openly, yeah, he wrote the Confessions, right? He wrote it publicly, so I'm not, you know, speaking behind his back. But he used to pray when he was a young man. He used to pray to God, right? God, make me pure, but not just right now. Which is a case of not aligning with the highest. If you know that that's what you have to do, well, that's what you have to do. As soon as you see it, do it, is what it means. All right. So those are the seven signs and symptoms that you're actually moving in the right direction. Again, it's not that you're the perfect healer or the perfect nourisher and the greatest protector. It's that you start feeling the inclination. That's the first thing, the feeling. Like, you know, in homeopathy, right? The most important thing is the mental change, right? Once there is a mental change, you know that there's going to be a physical change that will follow. So this is the same. When you feel the inclination to heal the sick, nourish the young, protect the weak, love the beautiful, serve the good, honor the wise, and align with the highest. When you start feeling that inclination, you know you're moving in the right direction. And the stronger the inclination, the more obvious it should be to you, because we need to know whether we're moving forward or backwards, right? We do need to know. Everything in this world has signs and symptoms. Everything. So today, we're going to look at the last two instructions in the second point, formal practice, in the how to cultivate the mind of enlightenment in a practical way. And there are two instructions. One of them is almost enigmatic, right? Three objects, three poisons, three roots of virtue. And the second one is for all objectives, train with recitation. So in our lineage, as we have been sharing, we have been given graciously by our teachers prayers. Prayers are the most efficient way in which human beings change their minds. If you prayed as a little child, you probably still remember those prayers, even if you have left them for a time. They actually start transforming your mind. Repetition is the way we learn. It is the way humans learn. So please recite with me. You all have a copy of this, Cultivating the Mind of Enlightenment. I bow to the Lord of Compassion. In contact with the objects of the senses, my karmic seeds, impressions, and formations produce paired feelings and emotions. Attachment for the pleasant, aversion for the unpleasant, indifference for others. Bless me to know that all are of one taste. Upon meeting my parents, may I desire for them, as I do for myself, the greatest good. Bless me to see in me and them true purity, true self, true bliss, true permanence. May I always recall the everlasting, the ground of all, the noble Lord, the blessed one, the Buddha, who is suchness. Remembrance of the Buddha is the mind of enlightenment. There is no safer refuge, no greater purpose, no more earnest confession, no rejoicing more full, no entreaty more candid, no purer dedication. The holy name is the all ground, the path, and the stainless fruition. Om Ami Deva Hri. All of these prayers, you may have noticed, start with I bow to the Lord of Compassion. As we have said before, the Lord of Compassion, yes, there is such a person, Avalokiteshvara, in Sanskrit, Chenrezig, in Tibetan, Kuan Yin, in Chinese, Kanon, in Japanese. This is our transgender Buddha. But again, let us be clear, whenever we invoke the Buddhas or the great Bodhisattvas, we are not invoking external being. We are invoking aspects of our own Buddha nature. There is a Lord or Lady of Compassion in your true nature. That is who you're invoking. And we are invoking this particular aspect of your Buddha essence because at this moment in our lives, at this moment in our experience as ordinary beings, we are worthy of compassion. If we don't have compassion for ourselves, who will? So we invoke the Lord of Compassion, which gives us two things. First, it allows us to recognize, I need help. And the second is, I am worthy of help. And we need to understand both. Because sometimes we know we need help, but we reject it because we're not worthy. Or sometimes we think we're so worthy we don't even need help. And those two are very big problems. Very big problems, right? We all need help, and we're all worthy of receiving it. The fact that we exist is the evidence that we are worthy of compassion. Remember that in Buddhism there is no blame and there is none. There is no reason for it. If somebody hits you with a stick, would you blame the stick? It would be foolish to blame the stick, right? Because somebody is wielding it. Whoever hurts you, or if you hurt another, you are being wielded, you are the stick. And you're being wielded by ignorance. Blaming the person is foolish. That doesn't mean that you go and say, you know, hit me again. It means that there is no blame. That's why in Buddhism also there is no forgiveness. Some people freak out when I say, you know, Buddhists don't forgive. There is nothing to forgive. In order to forgive, first you have to blame someone, right? Oh, I forgive you, which means I put the full blame on you. And now I forgive you. You've been so bad, but I forgive you. You were terrible to me. You hurt me so much. Forgiving means assigning blame. There is no blame to assign. We're all ignorant in different degrees about different subjects. And the only thing that ignorance requires is correction. Not blame, not guilt, not forgiveness. Correction. If you have a child and the child is doing something wrong, would it be helpful to the child to constantly say, I forgive you? Help, teach the child how to do it right so you don't have to forgive them anymore. Ignorance requires correction, not forgiveness, and certainly not blame. So we invoke the Lord of Compassion, our own internal Lord of Compassion, who kindly manifests externally. Because some of us are so separated right now from our own Buddha nature, from our own enlightened nature, that we can only conceive of an enlightened being as separate from us. So in the kindness of your own Buddha nature, your Buddha nature poses as an external being, but it's not somebody else. It's not somebody else. So the first stanza here, in contact with the objects of the senses, right? Whenever we see, hear, touch, smell, taste, Remember that in Buddhism, the mind is also a sense, right? Because what is the object of the mental sense? Thoughts. Thoughts are the objects. So whenever our senses enter into contact with the objects of the senses, our karmic seeds, impressions, and formations, these are just terms that we use for how deeply they affect us. A seed is powerful, but not as much as an impression, sometimes also called a fat seed. And formations is when they actually are so ingrained that they are almost like riverbeds that guide our experience. You know, sometimes have you ever wondered why you want to change something but you keep doing the same thing? That's a formation. It's very strong, it's very powerful. So what we're saying, whenever we come in contact with the objects of the senses, these karmic seeds, impressions, and formations, it's not coming from outside, they produce paired feelings and emotions. What are the feelings? Pleasant, unpleasant, neutral are the three feelings. The emotions associated with those feelings are attachment, aversion, and indifference. And in Buddhism, these are considered the three poisons, because on the basis of those three, of attachment, aversion, and indifference, we generate actions that are harmful to ourselves and others. And that is the only reason we engage in unskilled behavior. We do it either because we're attached to something or someone or some situation, or because we hate someone or something or some situation, or because we're indifferent to something that we should actually be paying attention to. You have children. Sometimes indifference is actually willful. I don't have to study for that test. Or, you know, we do that all the time, right? The deadline is not really here. Right? So what do we ask that internal Lord of, or Lady of Compassion? Bless me to know that all are of one taste. What does that mean? Obviously, they are different, right? Something pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral is different, and the three emotions are different. Why do we say then that they are of one taste?
Because they all go away.
And they are all deluded. They taste plastic. If you really taste them, they're plastic. It's like, did you see that movie, The Matrix? Mm-hmm. When they were sitting down eating in that grungy thing, and they were eating some gruel, and said, tastes like chicken. And one of them said, everything tastes like chicken. Well, yeah, right? If you really analyze your attachment, your aversion, your indifference, it's all artificial. It's all artificial. It has no substance. It's of one taste. And give it 5 seconds. It will go away. It will change. It may even change into its opposite. Isn't that what divorce is? Attachments changing into its opposite? Actually, and some do not end in divorce, some end in indifference, which is, yes.
So I interpreted this different, tell me if mm-hmm. I'm wrong. It says that, and I know this is true, every sensation is an ever against, and both, you have both at the same time, and eventually you pursue one or the other when you want to come around.
Mm-hmm.
So then when it comes down, know that they're one taste, I interpreted that to be that it blessed me to know that there is no difference between the pleasure and the pain. Joy and sorrow, there's no, it's one and the same.
They're faces of the, two faces of the same coin. Right, yes. They are one taste because ultimately they cause suffering. Attachment leads to suffering, aversion leads to suffering, indifference leads to suffering. They have the same taste.
So when we say attachment is a feeling that leads to suffering, there are some feelings like love for family, for example.
That's not attachment. It can be.
Mm-hmm.
You can love them and you can be attached to them. But
it could also be concern for their well-being and desire to relieve their suffering.
Right, yes. But attachment is always about us, not about them. It's like, I will be happy if this one is here or this one is... Like, wishing someone to be happy has nothing to do with me. But if I need them to be happy for me to be happy, that's attachment.
I'm attached to my mother being on this side instead of leaving, which is inevitably going to happen.
We all, I mean, I'm not saying that we're free of these things, but we have to begin by recognizing they're all of one taste. If we are attached, we will suffer. If we are averse, we will suffer. If we are indifferent, we will suffer. They are the same. They're different routes to the same destination. Our GPS is stuck on suffering. Take whatever route you take, it's going to get you there. Some are longer, some are shorter, some are pretty, some are gritty, right? But they all bring you to the same place. They're all of the same taste. Now that's with all the objects of the senses. Now in the next stanza, upon meeting my parents, and we have to remember here, parents in Tibet means all sentient beings. It does not mean your current set of progenitors. It means all sentient beings. Because we should start looking at all sentient beings as our parents. Because no matter how we may like or dislike them, if it weren't for our parents, would we be here? I mean, that's a very simple question. No matter what they did after producing us, if it weren't for that, we wouldn't be here. So at the very least, we owe them this precious human life. And I know some people say, oh, I don't owe them anything, I made myself. No, you did not put together the sperm and the ovum. No, you did not. They did that. Of course, now a physician can do that. But they still need
the parents, yeah.
They still need the parents, yes. So upon meeting my parents, may I desire for them as I do for myself the greatest good. It's very easy to want good things for ourselves, isn't it? So here we're being told, may I desire for them as I do for myself the greatest good. Now, mind you, we don't always desire the greatest good for ourselves. In fact, most of the time, we are, how do you say that when you choose a lesser? We settle. We settle for bah, for garbage. We settle for garbage. We can be perfectly and permanently happy, but no, what I really want is a pair of, I don't know, Prada shoes. Be happy at Payless. If that's what it takes, I'm not saying that Payless will make you happy either. Yeah. Probably won't. But we're always settling. So we should wish for them as we do for ourselves the greatest good, nothing less. Why should we wish for anything less? And what is the greatest good? Full enlightenment. Liberation from suffering and the capacity to liberate others. That is the greatest good. Wouldn't you be incredibly happy if you could just right now make your mother permanently happy? That would be, yes. And you can. So that is the greatest good. Everything else is just peanuts. Bless me to see in me and them. And here sometimes people say like, ooh, you know, these Tibetans are always like putting themselves first. If you don't see it in yourself, you will not see it in them. What is it, true purity? We have a mantra. My teacher was very, very fond of this mantra. Om Swabhava Shuddha Dharma Swabhava Shuddhoham. Om, all is pure as it is. I am pure as I am. Not as I appear right now, right? As I am, as is my essence. So we need to see ourselves and others as pure. Right now, we are covered over But a covering does not change the essence. If I have a diamond, a perfect, beautiful, shiny, luminous, perfectly cut diamond, and I stick it in mud, and the mud covers it up, is it any less carats than it was before? Does it have any less brilliance? Does it have any of its qualities have changed? No, none of them has changed. The diamond still has all the same qualities. Right now, it's just covered with mud. So we need to start seeing in ourselves and in others true purity. And that true purity manifests three ways. True self, nothing false, true bliss, and true permanence. That is our nature. That is our nature. That's why we are never happy when we... Don't people say like, oh, I'm not happy here, I can't be myself. Isn't that what people like resent the most? When they're forced to be somebody else? So, true self, true bliss. Does anyone want to be unhappy? No, nobody wants to be unhappy because our nature is to be blissful and true permanence. Nobody wants to die. Now, some people right now may be suffering in such a way that they think that death may be preferable, but it's not their first choice. If they were happy, they wouldn't choose to do that. So nobody really wants to die. Or, you know, there are heroes who will choose to die to save other people. But it's not because they want to die. It's because their love for others is greater than their self-interest. But it's not because they want to die. So true self, true bliss, true permanence. We need to start seeing it, as difficult as it may be, in ourselves, so that we can see it in others. And sometimes it's a little bit easier to see it in ourselves, because you ever wonder how, if you do the same mistake that somebody else makes, they're stupid, but you understand why you made it? I understand how I made that, how I did that, but you're very stupid. So you understand a little bit more that the conditions may have forced you to do something stupid that you really wouldn't want to do. Now, this one is difficult for people who are, actually it's even difficult for some Buddhists who are antagonistic to devotion. May I always recall the everlasting, the ground of all, the noble Lord, the blessed one, the Buddha, who is suchness. Here again, we are not invoking an external being. When we say, may I always recall, what? Your own Buddha essence, your Buddha nature, the Buddha that you are. And there, it's not mere coincidence that these words are chosen, the everlasting. What does everlasting mean? That it's always been there, and it always will be, no matter how long it takes you to manifest your full enlightened perfection. It doesn't go away. It's always been there. It will always be there, the everlasting. The ground of all. It is what holds up everything right now. We exist because we are Buddhas. There is no other reason. Mistakes are actually ignorance, and ignorance in a true sense does not exist. The ground of all is enlightenment. The noble Lord. Noble, I think we still, although it's not something that we cultivate in this society, but what does noble Lord mean? It's someone who behaves always guided by principle. Doesn't that, I mean, when you call somebody noble, we're not talking about nobility. We're not talking about aristocracy. Who is somebody who is noble? Somebody who acts according to principle, whether it is convenient for themselves or not. That's what the noble Lord means, the principled one. one who does not compromise for self-benefit. The blessed one. What is the blessed one? Have you ever done a favor for someone and they bless you? People who do for others are blessed. That is the meaning of blessed. There are people who share, people who help. Those are the blessed. Who is? Think about it. Has anybody ever blessed you when you like cut them off on 75? Has anyone ever blessed you, you know, when you slap them? No. People bless you when what? Well, when you sneeze. And well, that's a different thing. But people bless you when you do something good. So the blessed one is one who is all constantly acting for the welfare of others. The Buddha. Buddha means the awakened, who is never under the thrall of illusion, never under the thrall of ignorance. And then, in case we have some doubts that we're talking about some being, the prayer says, who is suchness. Suchness means all that is. We're not talking about an individual. There are individuals who embody suchness, but no individual is suchness. The historical Buddha, Shakyamuni Buddha, is suchness, but suchness is not Shakyamuni. So now we continue. Remembrance of the Buddha, right? Of that one who is everlasting, ground of all, the noble Lord, the blessed one, the Buddha, who is suchness. Remember, who is you? Your true self. Remembrance of the Buddha is the mind of enlightenment. That is a very, very bold assertion, but a very true one. If you always remember your true self, that is enlightenment. That is enlightenment. There is no safer refuge, no greater purpose, no more earnest confession, no rejoicing more full, no entreaty more candid, no purer dedication. Some of you may have astutely figured out the relationship of this to the seven branch prayer. The seven branch prayer is the essence of the path. And I will recite it for you. I take refuge, number one, seven branches, right? Number one. I take refuge in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. Two, and generate great purpose for the benefit of all. Three, I confess my transgressions and abandon commitments. Four, and rejoice in the virtue of holy and ordinary beings. Five, I beseech the Buddhas to remain and turn the wheel of Dharma and dedicate all merit to great benefit. Now, with that as a background, remembrance of the Buddha is the mind of enlightenment. There is no safer refuge, no greater purpose, no more earnest confession, no rejoicing more full, no entreaty more candid, no purer dedication. In others, it is the seven branch practice. To remember the Buddha is actually the best way of fulfilling the seven fundamental practices. And then we go, and this is where some people become allergic. The holy name is the all ground, the path, and the stainless fruition. Om Amidevarri. The holy name is Om Amidevarri. Again, we're not calling on somebody else. Who is Amideva? First of all, let's understand, Ami means infinite. Deva means shining or radiance. What is the infinitely radiant? It is your Buddha nature. We said, go back an hour and a half, what is the nature of your own mind? Peace and clarity, clarity, luminosity. Amideva, it's boundless radiance. It's pure luminosity, is the total absence of confusion. And Om Amideva Ri When we say that, what we are saying is, may my Buddha nature manifest fully and pierce through all the veils. That ri is the piercing through all the veils of ignorance and confusion. Remember we've said we only have two problems? Just two. Wrong views, afflicted emotions. And what we're invoking our own Buddha nature is to cut through wrong views and afflicted emotions. Salud.
Can you say that again, Tashi? May my Buddha nature
fully manifest and break through or cut through my cognitive and affective obscurations. So it's not the holy name of somebody else. That is the name of the Buddha who you are. Now, this is one understanding of it. There are many others. We're not sectarian, right? Some people recite Amitabha. The Chinese say Amitofo. The Japanese say Amida. Some people in India say Amitayus. But it is always the same understanding. It is the fully radiant, the boundless luminosity, the unimpeded light of what? Of your empty and luminous nature, of who you are, without confusion, without agitation. That is who we are. Now, it says the holy name is the all ground. So it means it is the basis of your enlightenment. It is the path. It is what you do. To do what? To remember the Buddha, because remembering the Buddha is the mind of enlightenment. And it is the stainless fruition. It is the result. The result of the path is what? That you fully manifest your Buddha nature. So the holy name is the all ground, the path, and the stainless fruition. Om Amideva Ri. Yes?
What is the holy name?
Om Amideva Ri. Om Amideva Ri. Yes?
You talk about sound as the most subtle.
Yes.
Our experience. So if we actually heard the holy name, then we would recognize it as our own.
Yes. Yes. And in fact, there are Buddhist schools of thought, particularly those who follow Shinran. Shinran was a great Japanese Buddhist teacher who actually stressed more hearing than reciting the holy name. And they call it deep hearing. But they also recite it, because in order to hear it, you have to sound it. Although, you know, in our meditation, remember in the beginning, after we do all that we do, I say, now rest in the empty sound and the empty light. Don't look for it conceptually, but actually all of us, if the level of agitation comes down sufficiently, you will hear ri, loud and clear and sustained. It's not ri, 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 it's just one ri, but it's constant. And you will see the light, because Amideva is unimpeded light. You're actually looking into your own reality. And it has those two characteristics. It has many more, but these are the most perceptible of these characteristics, sound and light. Interestingly, we even have tourist attractions, right? Sound and light. Because human beings react most to sound and light. Name and form, nama rupa in Sanskrit, very common phrase you will find. Name, which is associated with sound, and rupa, form, which is associated with light, because without light you cannot see form. Nama rupa. And we say in our lineage, you don't have to look for these things. The sound will reveal the form. The form will reveal the qualities. The qualities will reveal the activities, and the activities will reveal the Pure Land, the place. the state. You don't have to do this. It's if you listen to the holy name, and of course reciting it helps you listen, because reciting, when we start reciting, we're not really listening. We're not even reciting. You know, our mind is split in a thousand different pieces. So what we're doing is we're training at reciting. That's why people say, like, well, you know, if hearing it once is enough, why do you do it over and over and over and over? Because we never really do it. So what we're doing is we're planting the seed so that at some point we can actually hear the holy name. And when we hear it, that's it. Yes.
May I ask, holy name is Ri or is it Om? Because the
Om Amideva Ri, the whole mantra, yes. Om is manifestation. It stands for, well, it depends on the construction. In the construction, Om Ahum is the, Om stands for the pure body, Ah for pure speech, Hum for pure mind. When it is just Om, it stands for all three. Pure body, pure speech, so full manifestation.
That's also A-U-M?
A-U-M, yes. A-U-M. The Sanskrit is A-U-M, but nobody, it's pronounced Om.
It's the same. The same.
Right, it's like in French, A-U, but it's, nobody says A-U. Yes.
So when they say that when you express gratitude, you can just repeat Om, it means that you are giving thank you for what is
it? Yes, yes, it's possible, but everything has to be, Om is also just a sound. In Buddhism, we don't believe that anything is magic. And there's a lot of that going around the New Age, that, you know, oh, this is a magic phrase, and, you know, this does this, and this, and no. It depends on your intention. In order to have an intention, you have to have a clear understanding. In order to have a clear understanding, you have to have a clear transmission from the disciplic succession. Otherwise, it's, I don't know, what you read in the magazine, you know, next to the ad for the $1,200 little Om pendant Deepak Chopra is selling. I'm not making that up. I think it's made of rhodium or something. I'm sorry, it's made of greedium.
Yes.
Greedium?
Yes. Why would anyone need a $1,200, you know, mass-produced? Anyhow, so it is a very strong instruction here that we can, remember, go back a little bit, upon meeting my parents, may I desire for them, as I do for myself, the greatest good. And also may I always recall the everlasting. How do you remember? Because our minds are constantly agitated. How many stimuli do you receive in 1 hour? Let's not even talk about one day. So how do we maintain a remembrance of our own enlightened essence? And this is where Tibetan Buddhism says it's mantra. Mantra, literally, is a Sanskrit word that means that which protects the mind. What does it protect it from? Scattering. The mind will tend to scatter. It goes everywhere. It follows the five senses. It follows its own memories. It follows its own imagination, its plans. It goes everywhere. It's a little Buddhist twist on that joke, you know, good girls go to heaven, but minds go everywhere. Right? And they do. They go everywhere. So how do we protect the mind? How do we keep the mind on the remembrance of our Buddha nature? And it is, mantra is a great help to do that. Those of us who have practiced mantra recitation for some time know that the mantra will actually come of itself when you are in need of it. It will, it's the reciprocation. Your own Buddha nature will say, you know, you've been recalling me, I'm going to recall you now. It comes of its own, and it allows us to remember who we are. Who is my true self? Is it this like person who's now like angry and, you know, like a demon and trying to extract vengeance on the road? Or, you know that it happens, right? No matter how well-intended we might be, there's some people who just push all our buttons and they know the code and the sequence. And that's where you go, right? Ballistic. So we need a practice that is cumulative, that little by little, you know, when we're about to go off, it starts saying, oh, mami de barrio. And you're still, oh, mami de barrio. And you calm down. You remember your own nature. You remember this is worthless. Why should I go and dirty myself? Because literally that's what you're doing. How many times have you done things that later you say, like, this is not me? Why did I do that? You almost feel like you have to take a physical shower. Or you say something like, ooh, I should go wash my own mouth with soap. Right? And little by little, if you start practicing recitation, mantra recitation, I'm not saying that it's going to be tomorrow, but you will notice little by little it comes. And you know when it comes, it to me, it may be that I am more prone to that than other people, but you know when you start like going on the self-pity wagon? Have you ever gone in the self-pity wagon? It starts coming like, mm-mm. Drop it. It's nonsense. It doesn't mean anything. Get over yourself. It's fantastic, you know, because we are so prone to, oh, I've been so good and look at what's happening to me. I try to be a good Buddhist. Why does the light go out? We all have that, you know, and then, you know, okay, I'm not supposed to do this foolishness. It's easier, it becomes easier. It actually, I know it's hard to accept for some right now, but it actually makes life quite amusing, because it is amusing. It is amusing. Why do people go to see tragedies in the movies? Honestly. Because it's amusing. If it weren't amusing, people wouldn't go, that's a bad tragedy, I didn't enjoy that. But if it's a really good tragedy, you cry your eyes out, oh, I loved it. Why did you love it? Because you enjoyed it. It's amusing. It amused you. So life is no different, you know. When you are aware that it's a movie, it's amusing, whether it's a comedy or a tragedy or a sitcom. Unfortunately, most of us live in sitcoms. Yes.
I had to testify to the miraculous mind-protecting quality. I have to think about, you know, when animals get hurt or when you see a dead animal.
Yes.
And then in the old days, I would want to stop and go get it. Or really cry, just the first time I'm driving, I'll start, you know, really feeling sad about it, and it'll lead to another thought. And today that happened, and I chanted that, just the 10 repetitions, and I went by, and I knew everything was going to be all right.
Yes.
So it, in a way, it made me feel better, but it made everything.
Yes. And you can't help other sentient beings by getting overwhelmed. You're no good if you're overwhelmed yourself. And there's nothing you can do, literally, for a dead animal. They're already dead. But you can wish them well. You know, that there's a mental continuum that's going to go on to another life. And chanting for them is the best thing you can do. You can actually bring them to the Pure Land. The Pure Land, again, it's not a place. It's not the Buddha's, you know, spa and sauna. It is a state of being.
I also chant this channel. I just want to make sure that I do this correct amount of times.
Even once is good.
Yes.
Amideva is 7 times?
10, usually. But it doesn't matter. 7 is good. 7 is better than 6. And 1 is better than none. And actually, if you hear it, only once is great. What do we hear? I don't want to, you know, make you crazy. But, you know, Honen, who was a great Japanese saint, maybe I shouldn't say it. He chanted a minimum of 60,000 repetitions a day. That's when he was busy. He normally chanted 100,000. Yeah, yeah. Counting is not a bad idea. That's why it is. But, you know, there's a very nice practice. You recite 10 times, and it's very easy, you know, if you divide it into sets of 3. Om Ami Devari, Om Ami Devari, Om Ami Devari, that's one set. Om Ami Devari, Om Ami Devari, Om Ami Devari, that's second set. Om Ami Devari, Om Ami Devari, Om Ami Devari, that's the third set, and then you finish with 1. Om Ami Devari. That's 10. How long does that take? Seconds. It doesn't even take a minute. Do that 10 times a day. 10 different times. So when you wake up, when you take a shower, before your breakfast, before your lunch, mid-afternoon, before... Have you noticed how many donut shops there are in Dallas? I have never been in a town with more donut shops. Now that I moved to Dallas, you know, I used to live in McKinney, that we don't have donut shops in McKinney. But there's like 3 in every corner. I'm looking for, if anybody finds a vegan donut shop, please let me know. Because those are worth driving to. You know, when you have your donut, recite Om Ami Devari, when you drink water, when you, just 10 times, don't obsess. The idea is to include it in your awareness. And before going to bed, and it is... Sooner or later, sooner rather than later, it will start playing itself in your mind. We call that practice 10 by 10.
Is that similar to the Namo Amitabha?
It's similar to Namo Amitabha. We make a distinction, but this is a purely Tibetan understanding. We say Amideva is the primordial Buddha. Amitabha is the Sambhogakaya, or the glorious body of the Buddha, and Amitayus is the Nirmanakaya, or the manifest. But that's the Tibetan understanding, right? That's why when we invoke Amideva rather than Amitabha. But there's nothing wrong with invoking Amitabha. And the Chinese again say Amituofo. Tofo. I always have problems with that. That's it. Yes. And sometimes they'll just say Amitofo with one hand. You know where that started? You probably have seen it in Kung Fu movies. All these Shaolin monks saluting with one hand. That's actually a very sweet thing. One of their teachers had lost an arm, so he could only offer, you know, a two-handed salute with one. And they didn't want to make him feel bad, so all of them started doing it with one hand. Oh, that's sweet. And then it stayed, and, you know, nobody now even remembers why it's done. But that's how it started, the one-handed salute. Any questions?
Can I share a tip?
Please.
I was having trouble with it, doing 10-10. And following Tashi's suggestion, I took one little sticky notes, and I put 1, 10 times 10, set on my monitor. 2, 10 times 10, stuck on my mirror. You know, just around the house. So when I saw it, it was like, oh yeah. Oh my God.
Someone on your monitor, I wondered what it was. Yeah, because sometimes fighting the resistance is like the coming up against the resistance is like wrestling a bear. You know?
Yes.
I mean, it's just like you keep you're right there and you're just
like this, right? You've met yourself, right?
Yes. Actually, the sad thing is what you've met is the resistance of your mind. The mind is so used to doing what it wants, even though it's your instrument, but it's had free rein. It's not, that's why we call this mind training. It has to be trained. Mm-hmm. It's a pet. It cannot go everywhere in the house. It has to go only on the paper. But it's used to going everywhere. It's a try. You know, if you let a pet run loose, when you try to train it, it will fight back. And that's what the mind does. It says, no, I'm not going to let him run me. I'm going to keep doing whatever I want. I go, you know, Paris now, and, you know, Albuquerque next morning.
Okay, here's one tip that might be
yes.
So you get up in the middle of the night and use the bathroom. That is a great time.
Yes.
Your mind will start going, in the morning I can do this, but...
Yes.
You just don't know how many you can say.
Yes.
Anyway, that's my
choice. Yes, and if you are of a certain age, you may...
You use a hot drawer when you get home.
Yes.
You'll be secure of mine.
So why don't we recite 10 times and then dedicate? Om Amidevari, 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 Om Amidevari.
By the merit accrued through all our virtuous acts, may all be free from suffering and the causes of suffering. May all embrace happiness and the causes of happiness. May all abide in peace free from self-grasping. May all attain the union of wisdom and compassion. Om Ah Mum Soha.